Hey everybody, welcome to another edition of the Real Estate IQ Show. Today I have the great pleasure of having my friend Alejandro Leal, Life Insurance and Asset Protection Specialist, here to talk to us a little bit about risk mitigation and strategies for wealth preservation in our real estate investments. Alejandro, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Ricardo. Thank you for having me.
Over the last 10 years, Alejandro has advised over 250 family and investor groups in risk mitigation and wealth preservation strategies across multiple generations. And we have talked a lot about how when a group of investors, a family is considering a real estate investment, us as real estate investment advisors talk about market risks and volatility in the markets. We talk about exit strategies to consider for investors. But you have a much broader perspective on the subject. What are some additional layers, additional strategies that you advise your clients on in terms of risk mitigation and wealth preservation?
It will depend definitely on the type of family or on the type of group of investors that are involved in a single transaction or in multiple transactions. My message is that it's not that one size fits all, every single need of every single client, of every single relationship, but there are some other things that needs to be taken into consideration in order, for example, to minimize taxation, not only in the short, but in the middle, in the long term, and also to implement the right strategy in order to reach that goal of the estate preservation from a multi-generational basis, under a multi-generational basis.
When talking about real estate investments and you just hear what people think and talk about, I think one of the biggest myths out there and one of the most misunderstood parts of real estate investing is that people just feel if they simply set up an LLC or a legal vehicle that should be enough to protect them. Yet there are multiple ways to organize an investment that could actually be better. What are some of those ways that you have seen?
You gotta see it not only from a taxation point of view, but you also gotta see it from an asset protection point of view. It's not only an LLC, for example, it will not be a good advice to put inside a single LLC a group of properties. If you're talking or dealing with a group of investors, you will set up aside several of them, and you will also create another layer. If they are foreign investors, that additional layer of protection should be located outside of the US in order to avoid taxation. There are certain things that, for example, because we got a broad of different scenarios, as I said at the beginning, depending on the type of investors that we're talking about. But if you're talking about a group of investors where some of them are US citizens or US taxpayers, the entire conversations change. Because you also should take in consideration to implement strategies like, for example, buy-sell agreements. Let me explain you a little bit about what that buy-sell agreement strategy means. Let's say, for example, that you and I decide to become partners and to invest into a single piece of real estate. We are both partners of an LLC. What will happen if I die, Ricardo? What will happen to my investment? You're gonna have to deal now with my wife. And you love my wife, right?
Very nice person.
But definitely, but not, you know what? Not necessarily, you guys share our point of view of, for on the long term,
right,
what we wanted to do, or how do we wanted to reinvest that real estate asset, right, that we decided to put us into a partnership.
And this is a very real example because it's an uncomfortable one, you know?
Yes.
You decide to partner many times with friends or family, and these kinds of conversations are not always had before we go into the real estate investment.
Exactly.
So what are the kinds of strategies like a buy-sell agreement? What would that look like?
Well, that will be a contract when we set up the rules of what will happen and what will be my exit strategy under the understanding that what is the amount that, for example, my family will receive for the investment that we made. And we will put it out in paper, we will put it on a contract, but then come the most important part, how we're gonna fund it. And believe me, we are not gonna be able to cover and to explain every single strategy, but my point is, to your question, that you need to address certain issues, and not only fell in love with with a specific property.
Right, and that happens a lot. You find your real estate advisor, you go out, you look at 5-10 properties, you fall in love with the property, you don't want to lose it, you want to rush and put the contract, and you haven't kind of done the homework
exactly
that is required to set yourself up for success in the long term. We see this scenario too many times, especially with families, that part of the objective they have with a real estate investment is one day inherit it to their children or grandchildren.
Yes.
Talk to me a little bit about this.
We need to take in consideration what instruments are we need to put in place in order to have guaranteed that transfer of ownership among generations. For example, we need to have a will in place, mm-hmm. but a will not prevent you or will not exonerate you from the probate process. So you also should need to put or to consider to establish trust agreements, depending on the type of families, revocable trust, in order to for those assets not to go into the probate process, which can be very complicated. It never takes less than 9 months. It puts you on a very not favorable situation in terms of what I call an indirect tax, which is what we end up paying to attorneys in order to be able to transfer.
Right. And at this point, some of our viewers may be saying, wow, that sounds scary and it sounds complicated. Is it really? If we do this beforehand, is it really that complex?
No. What it's complex and what it's really complicated is when you don't set and when you don't consider addressing these issues mm-hmm. on time since inception in order to avoid all this yeah. process.
Now, many real estate advisors who watch this show are also invited to contact us to understand what kinds of questions and issues they should try to uncover on their clients to determine if their clients should come, for example, to talk to you, to talk to estate planning, a tax attorney specialist, to talk to certified public accountants that can help them optimize their tax strategy. This is the kind of teamwork that a group of professionals has to work together to ultimately help the customer. It's not just about selling the property.
Definitely, and that's where you find basically two types of real estate agents from my experience that you can see. You find the transactional real estate agent, and on the other hand, you really find a real estate advisor. A real estate advisor that really cares about their clients. And that's what I have seen with your group, for example, where you are acting like quarterbacks. Like quarterbacks in what sense? That you are able to sit them with the CPAs, with the estate planning attorneys, with the life insurance specialists, with the asset protection specialists, in order to do things right since inception.
One of the guiding principles that we have here is that we don't know what we don't know. Okay,
yes.
And so we do this repetitively. You do this every day.
Yes.
And when a client comes off the street and they don't know what they don't know, we want to try to advise them so that they can optimize that objective. So it starts with setting the objective, and then it starts with taking them to specialists that know what they don't know, and then try and build the puzzle together.
It's basically an educational process. What you're doing is that you're actually bringing education to the client. You're educating the client in order to take the proper steps.
Right.
So whatever investment that you are doing, you are able to minimize taxation. Mm-hmm. You are able to guarantee the transfer of the ownership from a generational point of view. Mm-hmm. And so many things that you are able also to protect that assets against creditors. Mm-hmm. Because that's something that some people don't think about that much. But remember, we live in a country of predators. I don't call it creditors, we call it predators. So in some instances, it's definitely a good idea yeah. to consider to establish certain layers of protections where we can definitely help.
Including protection from creditors for activities unrelated to the
Completely.
Real estate activity.
Completely.
Where you want to preserve that real estate activity, especially if you have other partners.
Yes, and there are certain strategies that I don't think that we have enough time in order to explain it, but what I can assure you is that you're sitting in front of the right people that will sit you with the right counselors in order to set it up properly.
Tell me about the role of life insurance in the broader picture of risk mitigation and capital preservation strategies for investors. I think that when a lot of people listen to life insurance, they kind of have this thought of a life insurance sales guy who's trying to pressure you into a policy. But really, life insurance is one of the most critical components of a long-term wealth preservation and accumulation strategy. What is your experience with life insurance as a part of an investment strategy?
It's very appealing for most of the people that I serve that are basically vested into real estate. And let me explain you why. First of all, because it can definitely mitigate your capital risk. Definitely, it will minimize your taxation if set up properly for the domestic investors, not to say for the foreign investors, where it's a tax-free asset, including the death proceeds. Understanding death proceeds as the coverage will be completely received tax-free, no matter the ownership of the policy, which is something that we need to take into accountability when it comes to domestic investors. But let's say, for example, you can name a broad of circumstances where it actually adds a lot of value into a certain real estate investments. We were talking priorly, for example, for when we are in front of a group, how we fund that buy-sell agreement that we were talking about.
Right.
And you will see, and you can look all the literacy that you want, and you will find that the best way to fund those buy-sell agreements is through life insurance. But at the same time, that life insurance policy can also provide certain additional values to the investments, not only providing liquidity at the moment of death, if we're talking, for example, in the case of an individual, not only to hedge the taxation if we're talking about a foreign national doing real estate investments in the U.S., no matter if you're setting up properly all the layers that we were talking priorly in terms of an LLC and an offshore company, getting back again to the foreign investors. There are certain strategies that certain people, it's a shame that they think that it's one or another.
It's a misconception.
It's a completely misconception. I mean, they complement each other so well.
Right.
And they can add so much value to the families in terms, as I was saying, in terms of liquidity, in terms of hedging against state taxes, right, in terms of creating additional assets that will be protected against creditors, in terms of being able, for example, to fund buy-sell agreements for real estate investment groups.
Yeah. And one of the areas that we have seen life insurance most effectively involved is when a head of a family does a real estate investment, and they, with the objective of inheriting it to their children and grandchildren, and when they pass away, especially foreigners, the estate tax is so big and it falls on the heirs. And now the heirs don't have the cash flow, the liquidity to pay for the estate tax, and then they have to sell the asset, which was the exact opposite of what the matriarch or the patriarch wanted with the original investment.
You are completely right, but let's say, for example, that subject is covered. Let's say that you are a foreign investor and that definitely you were able to avoid the state taxes over that real estate assets because you were able to set up the proper layers in terms of offshore companies, in terms of LLCs. What else can do life insurance when that strategy, when those layers are put in place? It's bringing liquidity. Why? Because even if you don't pay estate taxes, you're going to still be obligated to keep paying property taxes, maintenance fees, assessments on certain properties. Where that liquidity will come from? And maybe the answer will be, well, it will come from renting those properties. And what about if I want to enjoy that property? What if I want that my family enjoy that property in the future?
Excellent point.
So yes. You see, it's not that one way or another, that it's a complete misconception.
Well, what it sounds like is that it maximizes the flexibility of options.
Definitely. Right?
And especially at a time when you're dealing with a painful death in the family, it's a very emotional time. Sometimes you're not, you know, completely focused on all the logistics and all the details about the investment portfolio, and this gives you a little bit of peace of mind.
Or the death of a business partner. Believe me, less what you want to expect is that the wife of someone that you trust so much, like to invest money together into a certain asset, knocks you on the door and asks you, where's my money?
Right.
No, we don't set up this business in order to sell the property. No, 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 but you don't understand. I need the money. Those are the types of situations that you can actually avoid.
Mm-hmm.
Not to say, again, Ricardo, we're not going to be able to cover all the scenarios where this can be so useful for so many families and for so many individuals. But getting back to the point, as I was saying at the beginning, every case is a different, completely different picture.
And with that, I'm going to invite all of you to reach out to us, ask questions, ask for advice. We are here as an educational resource so that our real estate investing community can make better decisions, create more wealth, and take that wealth far into their generations. Alejandro, this has been a great conversation. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much, Ricardo, for the opportunity.
We hope to see you again soon. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.